Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, I'm cordially inviting you all for this interesting lecture today, Challenges in Design and Construction of Tall Buildings in Sri Lanka. Our resource person, Engineer Shiromal Fernando, is one of the leading design engineer in Sri Lanka, especially for the high-rise building. So, anyhow, I have to, my duty to introduce him for the audience. Engineer Shiromal Fernando graduated from University of Moratuwa in 1994, and he has MPhil degree and member of Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka. He is the leading structural engineer in tall buildings, and also is a honorary honorary secretary for Society of Structural Engineers Sri Lanka. His I can't read all these things because he's very lengthy CV. Anyhow, his key project he involved in 48-story Siringo Celestial Residencies, Bank of Ceylon Kandy, Hyde Park Residencies at Hyde Park Corner, Trillium Residencies, Modern Fish Market at Paleoda, it's going, and he was civil structural consultant for Columbus City Center also. So today, we all know that one, in around Colombo there are a lot of buildings, high-rise buildings coming up, and so lot of buildings, but Shiromal's involvements are very important for that one, and he is busy with those projects. Anyhow, no need to take more time for my introduction. I will call Shiromal for this.
Thank you, Chairman, and also I would like to thank the Civil Engineering Sectional Committee for inviting me to do one of my pet subjects, tall buildings, and also I would like to personally thank Engineer Palagama for persuading me to talk today, because he said this is the first one in the year, so you should come and talk. So I thought to be the first is always good, because we don't know what the second will be. So I'm going to talk about challenges that I face during designing and construction of tall buildings. So basically, I will talk about practical work that I have been doing. I am very lucky to be in the correct place at the correct time. So I have got a lot of opportunity to design tall buildings. So this presentation will contain these. First, I will introduce the tall buildings, then the conceptual design aspects, and design and construction of the substructure, design and construction of superstructure, and other consideration that we need to think about tall buildings, because tall buildings are now the talk of the day, because the land prices are very high in Colombo, and we see tall buildings are coming in every aspect of the city. So we have to look at, since all of you all may be working on tall buildings, so it is time that we discuss it and learn from each other. So Siringo building, 10-story building, was the tallest building till the World Trade Center or Bank of Ceylon building was built. And so it's a tall building is a relative term. So it's based on the time, our heights may vary. So Sri Lanka is not new to tall buildings. our ancient forefathers has been built tall buildings for the last 3000 years our people have been. Still, this is the tallest big masonry structure in the world, 400 feet high. So we have a heritage of building tall buildings. If you go to the CTBQ website at that era, until the Eiffel Tower, this was the third tallest structure after Giza pyramids. So these are some of the buildings that I have been involved. In the lotus tower, 350 meter tall building. It will be the 90th tallest building tower in Southeast Asia, in the world actually. This will be the tallest in the world, Southeast Asia. And this is one of my first buildings that I, a tall building that I have been working on, the Colombo Hyatt Hotels, and it is now at come to the peak. Only the pinnacle has to come on top of it. And actually, this is one of my first buildings, the first building that I designed, a 10-story millennium house. This is also one of the buildings that we are working on with Diamond Studio, waterfront project. There are six buildings. And we are working with a great engineer called Cecil Bellman, an architect. And this is a hotel, this is retail, and apartments, and offices. So this is the guy I was talking about, a Sri Lankan. He is considered as the best structure engineer in the world. Recently, he got the knighthood from Spain. And we are also working with him. A project in Burma called Star City. There are 22-story buildings and 40-story buildings. This is also very, very challenging project because in Burma, it's very earthquake-prone country. Near to this site, 4 kilometers from the site, we have the fog line, which I am going to touch on. And also the cyclone path is also through this building site. So some of the other projects that we are working on is 40-story, 4 towers, Astoria Residences under construction. Access to the tower, we are the peer review consultants, a 29-story building, it's under construction. Colombo City Center under construction, it's a sunken design and build contract. We were the civil designers and also peer review consultants. We are also working on the capital of the city, 40-story, 42 towers, and the Trish Tower, which is going to come. And we are also working on the this is called the Wills Cup, a 96-story building in near Rajagiri, and this is also under design. So if you look at the world scenario, we are not so tall. We are in this will be taller than the Lotus Tower. It is 365 meter tall, and you find the Indo Cricket Stadium. That actually the concept is the cricketers won the World Cup, and they have got this plot of land, and they wanted to build something, and with the Indian developer, there are 3-4 bats and a ball. What the concept designed by come up with by Indian. And we are working with such engineers called Patel to develop the concept and also the superstructure. So that is 360. Now these are very much taller buildings with respect to the world scenario. So we have not come to that level now yet. So if you look at, hopefully one day we will be the tallest building in the world. Hopefully, then all of us will be a part of it. So this is the skyline that you see. If you go to Lotus Tower and take, you will see the Hyatt Hotel. There are other skyline, but it will be changed by 2020. Our total skyline will be changed with these tall buildings, which are done by us and some other people also doing tall buildings, not only us. So this is the ITC Tower, Altea. Altea, we were the peer review consultants foundation, and Clear Point, we were peer review consultants, and World Trade Center, of course, there was there. And with respect to the design of tall buildings, concept plays a key role. It's very important to understand that the key role is the concept. Most of the buildings that have been designed, even in Sri Lanka, 90% of buildings are not been built because the concept is not good. It's wrong, right? Even you can you might have seen some of the buildings that have been designed and advertised has not been built because the concept itself wrong. Because sometimes the architects, they can build the tall building alone. The tall buildings, we can we have to have a timber. The architects, engineers cannot conceive the concept from the day one. They have to work with the architects, the engineers, especially the mechanical and structural people to come up with the concept. Sometimes people come up with a concept where 80-story building and the 60-story building have the same code, it doesn't work. So those buildings will never get built. So initially, when we try to design, and the building should be feasible, so financially feasible. Otherwise, if we have to be able to build. If this is a very funny building which cannot be built within the 4 years, you cannot say. We have to give the whatever the building that you build. If it is so he's asking me to stay here. My face is not going to go to the web. I will try. So very important that you get the concept right. So in this the whole process, the design concept is the key. We are the subsequently you have to do the preliminary design and detail. This is the design process, the total design for the conceptual design, preliminary design and detail design. So but the concept plays a key, because most of the cost, if you look at the time wise, it takes only 10% of the time. But the cost decision that we take is 80%. 80% cost decision. So feasibility of the project is we have to determine within the 10% of the time of the project. Otherwise, don't stay away, go and do the model and try to do the detailed design, because we have to see whether this is feasible. The project should be feasible, because if it is financial, if it is not financially feasible, the project is not there. So very important that we work as a team. The public surveyors, architects, structural engineers and mechanical and electrical engineers. So as structural engineers, we always think about the strength, serviceability and stability. So this is what we are taught at the university to consider. But the sustainability is a very important point with respect to tall buildings, because the operational cost is very high. We did an energy audit by the Green Building Council recently, WTC. The energy bill was 47 million per month. Water bill was 10 million per month. So very important we look at the sustainability side of the total system. Since this is not the topic of the day, we will leave that for another day. So when you look at the tall building in the structural sense, it is an inverted pendulum. So the shorter the pendulum, you have a lower period. Longer the pendulum, you have a larger period. So generally the period is the number of stories divided by 10. So basically 10 story building will have about 1 second period, and the 50 story building will have a 5 second period. So if you do a model, you should get a similar feeling in the model. If there is something, there is a huge variation, then you have to check your model again. So, and also the taller buildings are slender. It has a large deflection due to the wind. So the smaller building, if you design a 10-story building, you will have, due to the wind, you will have a deflection, structural deflection about 15 meters at a cyclone wind speed. Whereas a slender building will have a larger period. Now 50-story building will have around 200 millimeter deflection. So you need to have this kind of background information to take your initial concept. And also the top story buildings are moving. Every building moving. If you go in the car and then look at a lamppost, you can see it's moving. And don't get into accident because of trying to see whether this is moving or not. No? Just most of the time the traffic is not moving. Therefore, put your hands there and just look at the pole. It is moving. So similarly, all buildings are moving. The taller building also has a period of 5 seconds, or maybe even taller the building, it has a larger period. So this motion will give rise to acceleration. Now say for instance, like you go like that and it stops, the speed varies, then it stops. So again it comes like that. So the varying speed is induced to give rise to acceleration. So some people can feel even very low acceleration, like 5 mg. So some are people, but most of the people cannot feel, so especially in the top story. So therefore, generally there are guidance in the CTBHQ guidelines, where if it is office, we control acceleration to about 20 mg, and for apartment where people are going to stay for a long time, even in the night, we try to control the acceleration, top story acceleration to about 15 mg. That is one of the main things that the structural engineer has to do. We have to make sure that your accelerations are within the possible limit. So generally these are the criteria, and also top story deflection, it is better we maintain in this range. Initially when you are designing, make sure that you are within that range. Later on you can fine tune the design by introducing different dampers or something like that. Now let's look at the substructure. What are the design considerations? Basically you need to have enough boreholes. Generally recently also we had this argument with the entrepreneur, where he want to have few boreholes for us to design the foundation, because to save the cost of the investigation. Now if you go to the doctor, if they are asked to do this scan, but still you will do because this is your body. But see, imagine the people who are going to say that cost you are trying to save, where you are trying to spend couple of billions of rupees, but you are trying to save the site investigation for a couple of 100,000 rupees, right? So no logic. Actually, if you do a proper investigation, you can reduce the cost of the foundation. Generally, what I there are a lot of people every day. People are wanting to build something. They come to us, and generally, I give a very good, very very strong, very very difficult, very very stringent requirement for site investigation, because just to see whether this guy is serious. So generally good for the site investigation people, we are always, my site, I will recommend more boreholes than the required, actually not required, but enough boreholes that we need to do it, and all the tests that we need to do. So if he is very serious, that means he is willing to go through that operation. So generally, how the main problem for a junior engineer is, how do you locate the boreholes, and how deep you have to go. Those are the issues that we have when we starting our career to design a tall building. Now say for instance, now here this is the cover and this is another cover. Where we need, generally the guideline is you have to have minimum of 25 to 30 meters between the boreholes, and the depth of boreholes minimum 5 meters in the rock, far rock. Sometimes for the and also for lotus star, we have gone about 40 meters into the rock, just to check the geology of the structure. The whole thing can slide. There are very heavy loads, right? So we have to get in. Generally, we only now talk to geotechnical engineers. Actually, when we are doing tall buildings, we have to get a geologist to check the geological parameters in that area. So these areas only the podium where you can go 3 meters minimum, or we can have few boreholes. So BLR will give a lot of information to us. Basically, you will give the strength, the compaction or strength of the soil. It will give us the chemicals, the chemicals like sulfate, chloride in the water and the soil, and the quality of the rock. So very important to see all these issues by doing a proper site investigation. Now you can look at this is the hydrothermal site, the borehole rock, where you can see 5 to 10 meters you have a sediment rock. If you don't do a proper, I mean enough boreholes, you might miss this. And the piping contractor will come and say this is an unforeseen object where you have to pay him for the cost as well as the time. So very important that you do, and also you can see you after this you get a very some fractures in the rock, and you can get a solid rock, and also you might see a weak rock below it. So all this information is there if you do it to a proper depth, minimum depth. So after that you can predict the rock contours, and we know what we are going at. So very important we have enough boreholes. With respect to the foundation, we have two options. One is the rock foundation, which is on a very solid ground, or you can have a pile rock foundation. So we can analyze, there are many softwares, ETAP, SAP, same, so many softwares to analyze the foundation loads and decide what are the number of piles, what is the pile loads, etc, etc. So this is a solid model. If it is a pile graph, we can do a solid model and see what, how the stress is distributed and what kind of thicknesses that we need for the pile rock. Now here the lotus tower, the rock was very close, like 15 meters. Now since recently most of the projects I have been doing rock, there are a lot of basements, like 3-4 basements, then we can easily touch the rock. It's not good to have very small piles. You can straight away you can keep the foundation on the rock, and the rock strength you can take about 2500 to 5000 kilonewton per meter square. So this is the rock. So when you doing the substructure construction is one of the challenging things for a high-rise building. Most of the time very important we think about this aspect. One is the temporary retaining structure. Most of the time when we do something, we disturb the whole neighborhood, and their buildings are cracked, and then there are many litigation issues. One part of our company do only this. It's a very good income source for us, just to go and report cracks and then get some money for that. Okay, so if you are doing mistakes, we have a branch to get that recovery that cost from the tap. So dewatering system very important. We are going for few deep basements. We can dewatering system. We have to plan what is the system that we are going to do. We have to know and design. Waterproofing is another issue, but how to do this waterproofing. So I think we all learn this at the university, where you have to put the surcharge loads, soil loads, water pressure, and also the passive pressures. We can analyze analytically, or we can use a finite program to design the forces on the retaining system. This is called plexis. There are other programs like geofy, where you can do stage construction and see how the things soil structure interaction, and what are the kind of bending moment and shear forces that is come to the structure, and based on that you can design the retaining element. So this is if there are no buildings very close by, and the water table is very below low, and you can even use the traditional timber planks and steel beams. So this is a bit dangerous, but this is very cost effective. So you can do it, but if the water table is very high, this you have to check the stability. Otherwise, the people working here will be at risk. This is a contour board pipe. The depth excavation is very large. You need a very stiff retaining system. So you can use board pipes which has a gap, and we can do this is called contour board pipe, and the gap should be seen with a gout or gout pipe. This is called SECM pipe, where you design interlocking pipes where to reduce the water seepage. So this is Astoria where we are using retaining SECM pipes, because if there are a lot of buildings outside, if the water table drops, their buildings will get affected. So for two now this is a retaining system, a contour board pile that we have used for the retaining system of the two excavator raft. We have gone about 15 meters near the Bay Lake, and to see that we have used a gout pipe. And since it is a circular in nature, you don't need struts. The earlier one you need struts, because the total membrane action will hold the retaining system, right? So it's you can dig very even circular basements are preferred, because you can do it with strut feet. You can see that these are the contiguous piles, and behind that pile you have the ground pile to seal the gap. And mind you, we did very close to the Bay Lake. You can see there are no water seepage through the rock. And this is a sheet pile wall where you can anchor or prop it. So sometimes if you have in Sri Lanka, the law is you cannot anchor unless you have anchoring should be within your boundary. You cannot go to other people's, even if it is a removable anchor, you cannot put it to other people's boundary. So it should be within the boundary. In other countries, they are allowed to put removable anchors, but here we have to be within the boundary. So you cannot anchor it unless otherwise you have to support it. So if they are very close by buildings, we have to gout between the building and the sheet pile or whatever the retaining system. Otherwise, this building will get affected, and that there will be a litigation, and they can stop you by getting an injunction. And if you have slopes, we have to use shock plating to stabilize the slope. Otherwise, during construction, it might collapse. The main thing is to come from out of the basement very fast. Come out of the basement very fast. So you have to have a proper system. Spend some money on the basement, and within 6 months, whatever the building, you have to come out. So that is very important, that you plan the excavation properly, and also monitor the deflection. This is a guide to put the torpedo to check the deflection. So you can use the deflection. You can do the get X and Y deflection of the during the excavation. We have to monitor the deflection. Dewatering is very important. Dewatering based when you dig a pit, dewatering the water will come into the pit based on the permeability of the soil. So the system that you are designing should be based on the permeability of the soil. If it is the permeability is in the range of 10 to the power minus 7, so you don't need a system. It's very very impermeable. You can take the water out, water will not come again. And you can, if it is in the range of minus 5 to minus 7, you can do ejectors to take it out. Otherwise, you if it is less, you have to use deep wells. Likewise, different based on your soil, you have to use different systems. Now this is the deep well system that we have used when we are doing the lotus trap. And also surface dewatering. Most of the people forget. In Sri Lanka, especially in Colombo, every day there is rain. So during the rainy season, there is a lot of rain, due to sea more rain, more water coming into your excavation due to rain than the seepage water. So we have to make sure that the water that comes has to be tapped and put into wells, and then there should be a well system that take the water out. So this is, we have to plan that. Most of the people, we don't plan it, then we get in trouble because we are not. And also, after you put all the reinforcement, very difficult to take the water out. So you can have this kind of system where when the water comes, you trap it and then take the water out. So it's a very simple system. So this is a granular layer, and there are pipes which we have done and to lower and make sure that you have a dry surface to work. And very important that you have a pit, proper pit to sediment water, and then only the sediment, the good water has to be put to the drainage system, otherwise we will be blocking the total drainage network, which we normally do. With respect to waterproofing, you have two systems. One is the membranes, which I find very difficult to do because it's a wet condition. If it is rains, you have to have a perfect dry condition to do. And if you do a waterproofing, you have to have a fully dry surface, but it is possible, which we have been doing this. This is a membrane, 4 millimeter membrane. It's better to have two layers. If it is very wet, then you can put the second layer, top, the second layer on top. And this is a bentonite based waterproofing membrane, which we normally recommend now, because even if wet, it doesn't matter, and you can nail it, and there won't be any issues to the progress of the project. Very important that we make the life of the contractor simpler and not difficult. So bentonite with water, it will expand. So after you do sometimes drains, it will come and seal the gap. And these fibers will eat into the concrete, and it will stick until it's a bentonite is a mud, which is a natural material. It can long forever. And the other thing about the foundation is the all these foundations are very thick, 3 meters, 4 meters, very thick. So the peak hydration temperature is the main issue of a designer and also the contractor. It will give rise to many issues. So very important, we use the less binder. The cement is the main thing that will give rise to hydration. So we have to reduce the cement content as much as possible. So the maximum cement content or the binder content that we have limit to about 400 kilograms per meter cube, and the initial placing temperature will be one of the factors that will control the peak hydration temperature. So if you can reduce the initial temperature to 30 or less, it will help to reduce the peak hydration temperature. And also the other thing is when there's very high temperature, we normally always ask the blame the contractor not curing, but this is the only time we ask not to cure. We have to protect the concrete, we have to keep the temperature until 4 days without doing any curing. If possible, avoid curing, or you can do curing from compound to do that. And you can use fly ash or slag or silica film to reduce the OPC content, where we'll reduce the temperature. So to do that, you need to have a lot of trials. You cannot come up with one. So you need to change the cement content, you need to get the strength as well as the strength. So generally, with respect to the strength, generally we don't design more than 4 gate 40 concrete, because because you cannot improve the shear is the main issue in a pipe or a raft. So therefore, you normally because the maximum shear strength, shear capacity given by gate 40. Even you gate 40 code says not to use that, right? So do not use very high strength concrete for foundation and pile cap, because it will not contribute to the to your benefit. So after doing several trials, you have to get the correct mix. And that means we can try, do trials with different people, because only one supplier is not good for especially a large pool. Better to have at least 2-3 suppliers, and you have to do the same trials with different people and try to get some agreement between the suppliers. So you can do a trial mock-up to check whether your design is correct and see the peak hydration temperature. And this is a mock-up that we have done inside the ground. This we did at height inside the ground, and we have to, at different levels we can monitor the temperature, and the peak hydration temperature is better to be below 70. There is literature, you can go to about 85 if you use the PFA, where it will reduce the risk of delayed engine gas formation. And also, according to Neville, the how to reduce the temperature, most of the people use ice in the water and try to use temperature about 4 degrees. But what according to Neville, the biggest component in the concrete is metal. If you reduce the temperature of the metal by 1 degree, the temperature of the concrete will go by 1 degree. That is what Neville says. So most of the time, good that is here at Lotus, where we have used flake ice on top of the metal to reduce the temperature. But we have to be mindful that we should adjust the moisture in the concrete, otherwise you will get a lower strength. And when you do a large pour, you have logistic planning is the key. You know the traffic in the Colombo city, and we have to do it at one pour. The gaps of between the pouring should be minimized. Generally, the what we normally expect, that the rate of pouring is about 60 meter cubes hour per site per pour. So we have to plan how many suppliers you need to have, where they are going to put the pump cars, how many boom trucks we have to do. Generally, what my feeling is, we now request is you divide the pour into 4 pieces. You have dedicated pump cars for each pour, and use the pouring with at least minimum 2 suppliers, and then you build the concrete in layers vertically, so to avoid the cold joints. So, and also you can have a standby pump, so that in case there is a problem, definitely it's good. Most of the time we don't use the pump car. Generally, it is the main big pour, so don't use the pump car for the first time. Better do some trial pours before, even for a speed concrete, and because if something goes wrong in the major concrete, you will be in trouble. So these are, I am talking with my experience, these are the problems that I have faced, so that is why the advice I give. So the concreting is day to night. So generally when we did a pour for Lotus Tower, 4000 meter cube, 36 hours. So we started on a holiday, it was 8th August, 8 o'clock, 8 is a good number for the Chinese, and that was a Muslim holiday, and we closed the road because we had a lot of army power at that time, and we tried to put the, we were in charge of the total road, and the amount of you can have stored all the material that you need. We got four battery plant, and you cannot keep the material that you need for a total pour in your mixing plant. So most of the sand, everything was on the road filling. The cement silos, some cement boxes were there until Kalamia Bridge. See? So that is the kind of operation that we are talking about. So if you are planning the concrete, it's very important that you do the total logistics planning. Otherwise, you will have honeycomb, you will have at least your foundation. So this is our logistic planning. I'm just telling you because you have to see where the trucks are entering, where the trucks are going, and which designate, get all the suppliers in and talk to them. And this is dedicated, tell them that this is your Maga plant, this is Sanket plant, make sure that they are in agreement, because Maga doesn't want to pop concrete on Sanket, so there are other problems. So therefore, we make sure that the politics are sorted out. And so this is now, we can see with the foreign contractors, we see a lot of machinery in the site. So the pouring is very easy, and a lot of apartment that we can see in the pouring. This is from the dais. After pouring, we have put up polythene and sand to protect the temperature. Otherwise, if there's a huge drop between the pores, there will be micro cracks. So, and Professor Das personally monitoring the temperature. He has gone down from 15 meters down. Let's discuss about the design consideration for the superstructure. We have to look at the model behavior of the structure, very important. It will tell us where the weak axis is, and also it will tell how good your structural system is. And then the gravity load analysis, which we normally do even for a small building. Ductile load analysis is the most important, especially the wind. For Sri Lanka, the wind is the critical. Earthquake is not the main thing. Wind is very critical. I think Shahanaka doesn't agree with me. I don't know. So he did a master's in earthquake engineering. So I think so it is not waste, actually. Your study was very good. Actually, we are using it now. So wind analysis is the main thing, very important. Because wind acceleration we discussed, static analysis, dynamic analysis, we cannot forget the static analysis, very important. And earthquake static analysis and dynamic analysis, very important. And also there are other issues than the normal structure, like axial shortening, temperature movement due to the wind, the temperature movement of the structures, and the fatigue. So which I will touch. Hopefully I have some more time. Okay. So these are the serviceability limits that we have, the beam deflection, these are all we know. The wind load, I told you, the maximum deflection, we have controlled the building height divided by 500. And the maximum interstorey rift is 12 millimeters, so that there won't be any cracks in your facade. So there are many tools to analyze the structures now. This is lotus tower structure. I think the model was done by Dillinger. And this is the Eric structure, a very complicated structure. The model was done by Taranga. He spent about more than 1 month to do the model. We need to have an accurate model. We cannot now, like last day, last time, those days, there are no way of designing tall buildings without a computer tool. Of course, the basics we can do without computer, but the computer tool is very important because we have to do different models. We have to do so many options because the architects changes every time. Mechanical engineering requirements are there, client requirements are changing. So you have to have this knowledge. I think very important that as young people, we get these tools, used to these tools. And these are the two modes, especially the period of the lotus is about 7.39, the first mode. Second mode is 7.38, same, because both modes are the same. And the third mode is only 1.5. What actually it says is the third excitation is the mast. It is the mast. So the mode will tell with you where the critical things are. Very important. The mode analysis is very important. It will give you the first part, first indication where your issues are, where you want to look at. the gravity load we have to look at very carefully. Very important, we calculate the gravity load very accurately. Because if you add more weight, you are wasting money because you have to do more column, more pump piles. Larger column, more piles. So very important because it's adding 100 stories or 30 stories means you are adding 30 times. So error in the this thing will have will result conservative result or drastic result. Sometimes especially do a small first check when the especially these kind of things are done by the youngest member of the team. The senior actually has to have a small top check because if he miss a couple of floors, you are going to get in trouble. So better and also different areas you will have different loading. Very important that you try to do a load model. And with respect to the flow systems, very important, these loads are carried by the flows. Very important, we economize the flow. Don't try to economize the foundation, don't try to economize the column, try to economize the flow. Because say for instance, if you can reduce 1 inch from a flow, if it repeat 50 times, 50 inches, taller than me, it will reduce the weight of the structure, it will reduce the weight of the foundation. It's very important, you work to reduce the weight of the this thing. And also, very important that you look at the constructability. Now, if we try to see the constructability of the Sri Lankan construction practice, we normally put a one flow, one mark. If you do that, no employer will employ you. They will get somebody from India or Malaysia or Singapore to build this design. The constructability is very important. Maximum flow cycle is 4 days or 5 days. No more 7 days. So we have to design constructible flow plate and it should be very fast. So it should be simple for the contractor and your detailing everything would be very easy. So this is the flow plate that designed for the lotus tower, but there it's not a depiction, but there's a long span. Therefore, waffle type construction, and you can see the quality of construction. You can always all of you are welcome to come to lotus tower because sometimes in batches ISL bring engineers to the lotus tower. The quality of construction is super. I will tell you, not a single honeycomb. There is a myth that we cannot build without honeycomb. It can. If you do a proper mix, if you do a high performance concrete, you can get this kind of concrete. And you can have a fracture which will reduce the height of the structure as also very easy for the services. Services guys will love you if you do a fracture. Now there are a lot of you can use post-tensioning so that you can have large span with a very thin slab. This is, if you look at the lotus tower now, it's under construction. The tower house is built with steel. The steel structures are the other options. We are now building a multi-story building for Navaloka. It's a steel columns, circular color columns with concrete infills. We have found that it is very, very fast, as well as you can reduce lot of space and time. So this is the flow plate that I have adapted for the higher footed, where the spans are in the range of 12 meters, and the depth of the beam cannot exceed more than 600. That is very important. If you increase the depth, it will increase the height of the building. Of course, the tall building, the height is good, but but the point is that it will add to the floor space. So it will add to the facade. So maximum we can give to about 700, not more than that, because there are services going on. The service guys will also ask about 600. If we are on 600,200 only for structures, the occupied space is very low. So let's say one 100 millimeter, if you say, if it is a 50-story building, you can save a large amount of 50-story building, we can save about 5 meters. It will reduce the façade height, it will reduce the cost, likewise. So very important, you have, as a structural engineer, never ask for more than 600. If you are asked, they will come to me. Okay, so do not, so you have to design within. So there are different types, we can adapt different types of, this is Astoria floor plate, where we use walls as a structural system from the transfer plate, because this is apartment, so you have to have a solid plate. If it is office, you have to have a very flexible system. This is what I like actually. Now when we are designing a building, we design for 100 years. It should be flexible enough to change. Now actually when we design the height, we design as a hotel and a residential block. So, but luckily I selected this type of element without using walls, rigid walls. If we use the rigid walls, we cannot change. Finally, it ends up as a hotel, completely different, right? So, when we are designing, we have to have a vision, and very important, you have the core and also some columns, that's enough. Let the architects handle the interiors. And use drywalls, modular construction to the internals, so that within the 100 years, they can change. It can be office, it can be a hotel, it can be retail, right? So, very important. Have larger spans, don't put columns every 10 feet, larger spans, so that the occupants can change the structure, the inside, and they can use. So that is should be the concept. Now here, we have put all walls, they will never able to change, because these are structural elements, right? So basically it's very important, we use a flexible method, and we have not put any beams in between, so that the services can and also when you are designing this kind of thing, there can be a partitions for, don't use all the walls, make sure that you use minimum amount of walls that you need, otherwise clients always wanted to change in clients especially. So if you use as a structural wall, that option is not there. So flexibility is the name of the game. So very important that you have the flexibility in your design. And when you design, we can analyze and we observe. Generally, if you design this panel, like this is for everybody who has gone to the university, will say this is a one-way span is there. But the higher stresses are in the other direction, because these are large spans, so the beam doesn't, the slab doesn't bend the way we think, it bends in the other direction. So you need more reinforcement here, other, if you don't put more reinforcement, there will be cracks on top, right? So understand the structural principles, the stiffness, the slab will bend based on the stiffness. When you come to the columns, the columns are major component in this. So there may be few columns, but it occupies very large space. It's occupied by space, sellable space. It's very important that you reduce the size of the column, right? Because now here the admixtures are plays a main role in high strength concrete, because now Sri Lanka we have good admixtures. We can go to even up to 80-85. So if you use very high strength concrete, it is possible in Sri Lanka. It is not impossible. We are very advanced country. So we can use 80 Newton. So if you design, don't be afraid to design high strength concrete columns, and basically. The main issue is normally when you design a high strength concrete column, you keep a larger margin like 20. So the target mean strength is like 100, right? So you will never fail. You will be within the within the within this this design parameters, right? So there are a lot of fluctuations because high strength concrete is very sensitive to materials with respect to sand, water, everything has to be controlled. So better to you need to have a higher margin. Generally target mean strength should be around 100. So you have to use cement additives like silica fume is very important. Generally there are core districts and the Euro core district, the maximum use of cement silica fume to about 6%. Sometimes I don't know, the main reason is that when the concrete is very high strength, during a fire it can explode. So to reduce spalling, only they have limit the silica fume usage to 6% of the binder, right? So generally we have to when you have a higher strength, you have to go into very low water cement ratios. And also mechanical couplers can be used, and you can reduce lot of steel wastage because the lapping takes a longer waste lot of steel and it will consume time also. So we can reduce so much of steel. Now say for instance, for large column tall building, you need the 40 diameter bars, and if you lap say 52 times diameter, this is about 2.5 meters. So it is like almost flow height. So you use about 200% steel in that lap. So no point. So you can reduce a lot of things. So you can see this is the Hyatt hotel where people are inside this thing, and then this is the Swiss type couplers. There are screw type couplers. There are different type of couplers. This is the we use here, and this is 1.8 meter by 1.8 meter column, and people can go even inside. So when you are using couplers, we don't put all the couplers at the one level. You stagger the couplers. And here some of the strength results of grade 85 concrete. We have reached about 102, which we can get it at the site. Okay, so this is possible in Sri Lanka. And the water cement ratio is 0.25. Right, so admixtures are available. We can do it. And high performance concrete is very important. Now, a lot of people reject concrete because there is large slump. Don't do it. Now we tend to specify high performance concrete for pile cast because you can easily pour the concrete. So no vibration required, you can easily pour the concrete. And also for columns, walls, we want to put high performance concrete. It's very, very nice. There is no bleeding. It will flow itself. You don't need much vibration. And without, depending on the concrete compaction is mainly depending on the poker vibrator. And when you are doing a vibration for a column or a slab, there are so many engineers looking at it. Slab, actually you don't need to go. For columns, walls, foundation, there is no engineer looking at it, right? So actually there you need the most amount of engineering supervision. When you look at the mixed design, these are the mixed designs that we have used for self-compacting concrete. Generally the cost to fine ratio is 1, where the fines are more, right? So this is one thing that you can observe. And also when you are doing a tall building, the pumpability of concrete is a key thing. The higher the you cannot use the same mix for the lower columns and the upper columns or the walls. You have to change the aggregate size, and you may have to use additives like fly ash, additional fly ash to increase the pumpability. So those kind of things we have to look at. You can see the lower floors we have the aggregate size is 20 millimeters. When you go higher, for 45 meters to 195 meters, then the aggregates, the 10 millimeter aggregates are used, and you can see above 195 meters,
you can use the aggregate is more, and also we have used fly ash. Well, we have used fly ash to increase the pumpability. I just show you how the pumping scenario, where from the pump car it goes, and then there is a huge temperature due to pumping. When it goes up, this temperature might reduce the workability. Therefore, it goes through a cooling bed or water channel, and goes up to the top, and you have the pump car which is traveling with the height, and finally it is the one it's automatically done. So this is the pump car that we use for lotus tower. I will play this. You can see there is no vibration necessary. There is a minimum vibration we use. You can see the concrete is just flowing like water, and the drop height is also about 5 meters, because we cannot build this building every 1.5 meters. Because there is called elastic shortening, it will shorten the column, right? So this is not only this is what you see in the model. So sometimes when you look at the model, if you try to design with this one, so you will have different kind of bending moment. Actually, it is not going to happen, because when we do the corrections, right? So this is, when you analyze, you can see this is due to elastic shortening. So it can be due to can you hear me? Corner one. So the shortening can happen due to elastic shrinkage. When the water goes out, the concrete shrinks, and also due to the sustained load, the concrete gets shortened due to the sustained load with time. So elastic shortening, as you build, the E values are lower, so you will see a shortening is higher, and then when with time, within 1 month, the water will go out, the shrinkage will happen within first 1 month, creep will be there for a long time. So you have to account during the design, otherwise you will have issues. We will see now. Say for instance, Astoria, during construction, this is the tower. So this column is going to get shortened. This is the podium. So during the construction, we have a post strip. We don't connect it. So this post strip will look after the total axial shortening. After this is built, we will connect it. So there will be no issues. So similarly, we will have this thing. And also, there is one of our teams led by engineer Tisra looking at the shortening, of course, under the guidance of Professor P.R. Mendes, what is the differential shortening between this column and these columns? So what we do is we embed strain gauges inside the rebar inside the concrete columns, and we try to monitor the strain due to creep and shrinkage and elastic shortening. And other issues that we normally get in this high-rise building are transferring, because high-rise buildings are generally has lot of functions, the hotels, the motels, the retails, and also the apartments. So they change. Sometimes you need service transfer, you need structural transfers. When you are designing the structural transfer flow, The thing that I come across was the Hyatt Hotel, where the entrepreneur wanted the banquet hall here. Earlier, the architect were planning the banquet hall here because it's structurally easy for me. But the entrepreneur was very strong. He said, "I will never take." In fact, Dr. Vishalinga got scolded because he said that this is better than this. He said, "I never take no as answer." So in that case, actually, doctor wanted to protect me and make sure that this is a difficult task. He understands because it's a structural engineer, but entrepreneur wanted it. So we had to do it. The entrepreneur is our boss. If we don't agree with him, we won't have a job. So this is 30 meter span. On top of that, you have this apartment, the hotel room, and also the pool and everything. And the main thing, the idea was, when there's a banquet hall here, the evacuation is easy. Otherwise, in case of fire, there are a lot of people. The traffic is very high. Therefore, it is very easy to. So they wanted this thing here. So that is the entrepreneur's vision. But the structural engineering, we have to use to see how we are going to design this. Then how I did was, I initially analyzed this total structure. So I got about 2,200 kilonewton meters, but I realized. But this is not the way the structure is behaving. This is the whole structure I analyze. Then I wanted to analyze state by state. When the structure builds, what happens? Actually, when the structure builds, the beam deflect. We drove to the beam deflected beam. Therefore, if you look at the bending moment now, it is about 13,000. Because earlier one, the total structure up together and you get a very small answer. But actually, the structure, the point that you will remember is the state construction is very important, and otherwise you will make a big mistake. This is the beam. During the construction, Dr. Gurnam was very care about this beam, and he himself came and put another additional jack during construction. Right. He said, "Shiromal, can we tamper the other way and make sure that your deflection is zero after construction?" And I agree. He's a very smart guy, and the deflection is very low. I mean, we don't have even a single crack. Let's go to the wind. Okay, wind is very important. Wind is the key in a high-rise building. If you don't look at the wind, how can nobody can design? Because wind induced acceleration, wind induced deflections are the key to design a high-rise building in Sri Lanka. So we have three wind zones. Mainly, most of the structures are in Colombo. We occupy. We have the normal structure. We design for 33 meters per second for post disaster structure. Of course, the tall building is a post disaster structure. We have to design for 28 meters per second. Right. Actually, recently the Peradeniya University did a study, because I'm also in the disaster management committee. They did a study and came up with their wind map was completely different. They said the third wind zone has about 60 meters per second wind, and northeast has about 30 meters per second. But it was a bit confusing to us because all the cyclones are passing this side, and obviously Australians have done a good job by having a very large wind specifying a high wind speed here. But the finally what we got, when we investigate why they came up with this, is because for the last 30 years no anemometer was working in this side, so they didn't have data. So because of that, they came up with the wrong conclusion. But the good thing about the research is, Colombo also has very high punishment. You can see the recently some of the papers, there was a tornado and there was an issue in Bangalore side. Likewise, there are many issues. Like due to climate change, there is a possibility that you get a cyclone on this side. I don't know. Right. So anyway, so this is the wind speed. I advise law to design a higher wind speed. When we design the road tower, we design for 55 meters per second wind speed. When we look at the meteorological data, and this is the average wind speed with time from 1994 to 2004, Colombo Municipal Council 10 meter height wind data. So what we see is average, the maximum wind that we experience per month is about 20 meters per second. So we don't have to design the serviceability criteria need for very high wind speeds. So now obviously if there is a cyclone, the tall building people will feel the wind. It's okay, once in a while they might feel, right? So but every month you might get a wind speed more than 20 meters per second. Since you are in construction field, you all know at a high level, 5 meters per second wind, you cannot work, right? So very high. So therefore, the 20 meter wind speed is you don't need to design for 38 meters of wind speed for acceleration for serviceability issues. But yes, we have to design. But for serviceability issues, we can use a lower wind speed. And if you look at the direction, we have observed southwest has a higher directional speed than the other wind side. So these are the values that we are taking. You might adopt, you might not adopt, or you might adopt higher value. This is the one we use. 5-year return period 22.5 after this, and 10-year return period 27.5, and 50-year return period 38 meters per second. Right. So this is after studying, after discussion with Professor Bian and Mendes, and we are sticking to this, and we also have worked with Dr. John Holmes, is one of the wind experts. This is the values that we have finally boiled down to. And when you are doing a design, you can use the code equation, but higher, if you look at the code, it gives guidance up to 200 meters Australian code, even British code doesn't tell anything about the wind accelerations, right? So for tall building, you need to have a wind tunnel test, because it's very complicated. It is in a city, it has an interaction between the buildings, very difficult to model, right? So it's very important that you design, you look at your local conditions with respect to you are using a wind tunnel test. Wind tunnel test will cost about 4 to 5 million rupees. I think with respect to the complexity of the building, it's better to do the one. Sometimes because of that, you can reduce the facade forces, right? This is the lotus tower wind tunnel, a very large wind tunnel in China, which we have used a rigid model as well as the radaristic model to check the accelerations in the accelerations at the tower house. Okay. So when wind passes a body, with speed, it will give rise to vortex shedding to start, and it will not only pull in this direction, it will also pull in other direction. Because of that, you will have an along wind acceleration as well as a cross wind acceleration. Most of the time, cross wind acceleration governs the design. Cross wind acceleration governs the design. You can also have an airport if you have a very funny stuff. So I will. This is the. You don't need. I mean, there are virtual wind tunnels. This is done by Professor. Sorry. Professor Mendes, Australian group for the Lotus Tower. This is a fine CFD model where you can see the stresses, the deflections, and also it's a little bit slow. What I want to tell you is the deflection of the tower and the deflection of the mass is little bit different. So within the structure you can have two different type of, you can see you can see different motions or different behaviors. We also can, we have expertise in our team where you can model the wind through the building. Very important to design the facade, as well as you have to look at the wind pressures at different angles, and the pressures that occurs at the edges, we can calculate. It is not the same pressures that this is important for facade, and also you can see high pressures at the bottom where the pedestrian comfort is considered. Very important, we have to pay podiums where the wind travels, and if there are a lot of wind pressure, you cannot walk. Pedestrian comfort is very important during a wind tunnel. We can, the earlier one I showed is a virtual wind tunnel where we can study, do the preliminary studies based on the virtual wind tunnel. But we recommend you to do actual wind tunnel to get some better idea. And always we use the Iman curve to calculate the acceleration criteria, the permissible criteria. And if you look at one of the work that we have done, we can see the crossing acceleration at different wind speeds. And these are allowable accelerations by the Iman curve, and all cases we have to check for different towers and see whether it's okay. And also you can see the deformation due to the wind, and also we should make sure that the instrumented drift is less than 12 meters. And this is, I borrowed it from Professor. This is you can see a mass. This is like a chimney, and you can see that it's oscillating, right? And it can fail due to fatigue. At a low wind speed, it has. So therefore, if we are designing something on top of the building, we have kind of designed for the highest. It will fail way below the ultimate strength. Generally, when we apply fatigue, if we look at the stress to satisfy fatigue, we consider about 1/3 of the ultimate strength given by the code. Right. So generally, we design for 1/3 of the strength. Otherwise, you will get into disaster, and if it falls into somebody else, then you will be in jail. And this is a model done in ICSECM by Sir, and you can see we try to see the eddies formation, and also the we can calculate the torsion acceleration with these studies. And this is the tower. This is what we are going to come for the on top of the Hyatt Hotel, and this is the stack model and the pinnacle, and this is the wind study that we have done. This is called using micro CFD. So you can see the velocities behind the different bus sections at a particular wind speed. The main thing is you don't need, then we can find the critical wind speed that
that will cause the main damage. The what happens is the cockpit, mainly the cockpit will affect the movement of the tower. If that cockpit frequency equals to the tower the mass frequency, it will oscillate, it will resonate and it will fall.
So it can happen not only the highest wind speed, it can happen at a low wind speed. So it's very important you have a wind expert in your team to do that.
This is my inspection, on top of the district there are some holes inspection. So the Mahatma called me to inspect the district, so on top of the tower.
Earthquake is another issue that we have to consider. Sri Lanka is in a low seismic region, so there are less risk with respect to wind, but there are instances of Sydney, Australia also thought the same way, because we Australia and Sri Lanka are in the same plate, so the most of the earthquake occur in the plate boundaries. So Australia also didn't have the earthquake till late 1997. After the Sydney earthquake, they were considering, because not only at the plate, there can be intra-plate type earthquakes. And when you look at the history, there is a Portuguese note that in 1600, there had been an earthquake in Colombo, and about 200 people have died. So these reports, these incidents repeat. So we have studied this tsunami. So every 400 years it repeats. Now 1600, and then 2000, it's almost 400. Right. So there can be an earthquake within our lifetime. So we have been designing building since 1994 with the guidance of Dr. Jaising and Professor Mendy with respect to the earthquakes. And every day there are more than 2000 earthquakes in the world. Every day you go to the IR seismic monitor, you can see where we are and what are the things happening around us. So it's a very 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 active world. So we have to be very careful. We have to be, we should not take this lightly. So when the earth says, due to inertia, the forces in the top floors will have a higher load, like similar to wind. Wind also, the wind profile is very high, larger, the top floor, you get a higher pressure. But inertia, this here, because the ground shape, due to inertia force, you have a larger force on top. So, and also the mass P is equal to mm is the main criteria. Therefore, with that acceleration, you have a mass. It is a mass dependent. If you have a large mass here, it will attract more force. So, it will be distributed based on the mass of the structure. So, if there are sometimes the transfer force are here, it will have a larger mass and then it will attract more force. So, you can see that because of that, this is the Christchurch incident 2011. The top will get affected. Even during piling, during the ground vibration, most of the time the 10th floor people complain, not the bottommost floor, right? Because of the vibration of the ground. So what happens is that it's a cyclic force, and most of the time the hinges form. So if the hinges form in this way, it will be a stable structure. It's a good structure. But if the hinges form in your columns, then there's a disaster. So first we like to have the hinges form in the beams, not in the columns. So the columns should be much stiffer than the beams to happen there. Okay? So this is all the basics. So when that happens, when the earthquake, the soil becomes liquid due to the energy. This is called liquefaction. So we have to look at the liquefaction potential during the site investigation level. So we tried to do this
this test in Sri Lanka, but very we don't have geotechnical people to do this shear wave velocity test. But we can use the if this soil is dense, this liquefaction potential is low. That is how we now normally do carry out. So if the SPD values are more than 50, the liquefaction potential is very low. Otherwise, there is a possibility of liquefaction. So in that case, there is a possibility of liquefaction in your site. Then the top part of the pile, you have to allow for you have designed to allow for the movement. You don't restrain that to make sure that it is on the stills. So you don't put the soil support to the top of the pile. To design using that as a column. So if you have there is a liquefaction, buildings can collapse, and there can be pounding also. And mainly due to the earthquake, the joints are the mainly the issues. So you have, if you confine the joints and make sure that there are no laps, you can see the bar pulling out from the joints. It will affect. So mainly. The columns. So what normally we do is we make sure that the more links are very close to the joint, and also the joints are not very closely placed to the very close to the joint. So it is away from the joint, about two times the height of the beam. Or with respect to columns, we make sure that the column and that are in the middle, not in the and we normally provide shear link very close by, like 200 meters millimeters. This is more than the requirement of the British code. So generally, when you are designing for earthquake, you have to use accession provisions. For you have to do two methods. One is the static method as well as the dynamic method, where you have we are normally for designing for this thing, we can use this coefficient for designing for static load, that is a coefficient related to 500 year return period. And also this is actually developed by the Pierangeli and Blue. If there is an earthquake at 30 kilometers away from Colombo, these are the response vectors that they have developed. And if it is a 50-year return period earthquake, like 0.05 spectral acceleration, 0.2 for 500-year return period, 2500-year period, 0.4. Generally, we have to satisfy at least this response vector, because this is very low, lower than the wind load. So obviously this will not affect much, this one pattern will not affect much of the structural design. So how to design this for earthquake, how to design, what is the criteria allowed to do earthquake? Now this is the criteria, we use a performance criteria. How the performance criteria is like after the earthquake, it should be, it's a demand by the plan. If you want, now if it is a, if it is a very important institute like hospital, fire brigade, after the earthquake it should be operational. If it is a office or apartment, it should be operational immediately. So life safety can be another option. Collapse cannot be tolerated. So very important that a banana boat buildings collapse during a major earthquake. So the performance criteria that adopt is the drift. Now if the top if the drift is very large, the interstitial drift is very large, then there will be cracks. So if you control the drift, then we know your structure will be okay. You can immediately, okay. If now what this guideline says is, if the drift is less than 0.2%, you are okay. If it is 0.5, it is immediately occupied. So if it is 1.5, 9.3, like correct? If it is more than 2.5%, the drift is the interval drift is more than that. So these are objectives. So basically, we have to aim at least immediate occupancy 0.5% after a 500 meter period earthquake. So this is the drift ratios. You can see based on if there is a transfer plate where you have a larger drift, and you can see the drift ratio is less than 0.2. Drift ratio is less than 0.2. So to implement this, you have to consider at least 90% of the mass, the 90% of the mass should be participated. The motor mass participation should be more than 90%. So to do that, you might need more than here we need a 40 modes to be considered. But generally we may use about 3 or 4 modes maximum. But if you are doing earthquake analysis, you have to consider at least 90% of the mass participation. And also you have to do the static analysis and weather dynamic analysis. Sometimes your dynamic analysis results can be lower than the static analysis. In that case, you have to use about 80% of the static analysis base shear values. So you can see the base shear at different heights. And also the solid ridge. So if you look at the solid ridge, 500 year, 0.8, 0.08, it is also static analysis. The dynamic analysis is much more. So 50 year return period earthquake, 0.09, this is 12.3%. It's also immediate occupancy. Here, also immediate occupancy. So in Sri Lanka, we don't have much problem with earthquake if you have a building is okay. And this is response vector. This is the project that I talked about, this Star City project, and the fault line is here. Fault line is here, and only 440 meters away. And one great earthquake every 770 years. One major earthquake every 10 years. One strong earthquake every 2.5 years, and there are about 9 moderate earthquakes every year. Actually, every week we feel a tremor when we go there. And when you look at that, this all in that Burma, you don't get feel rock. We have the all piles are embedded in soil, so the depth of the piles are about 60 meters. And the soft, very soft in the top. Therefore, we make sure that we don't allow any lateral support with the top. And you can see higher bending moments in the top of the pile. So you need generally here when we design, we use about 0.8 to 0.1% steel in the piles. But here you have designed the piles for this big growth. Superstructure consideration, I have few slides, I will run pretty fast, I know you all have to go home. Columns, the form curve system is very key in this system. You can have aluminium form curve, system form curve, in the system, in this thing. Most of the time we have used aluminium form curve. I think all the other contractors follow that, and most of the people now use system form curve. But the new construction, you can see Altea, they are using system form curve, not aluminium, right? So, and also very weak, and normally when we are doing a normal structure, we put the form curve and form curve from the bottom. Here it is the jump form, right? You imagine a high lotus tower, we put the form curve from the bottom, it is another building. Right, so jump form, you can jump from one place to another, and in that case you need to have very high strength. Every day we jump, After we put in concrete, within 10 hours we have to jump to another level. So you don't have to have early strength gain. And also as engineers, we have to also, we don't expect 20 kg strength at 10 hours. Cannot. Unless it is a leaning. With a leaning, yes, you need to have some strength because the reference was a little bit long. Therefore, if it is leaning, you need to have the strength within 22 hours. But if it is vertical, you don't need that strength. There is no load, only the self weight. So 10 newton per millimeter square is more than enough.
This is how we did. This is the
proprietor's video.
This is how we jump. This is the actual.
And also the main thing is in the vertical element, tower is surveying.
Key. I will tell you the key aspect is surveying.
The surveying, very important to have external surveying in other tower buildings and also internal surveying. So I normally tell you have to locate one point, you have 2 meters. Maybe a laser, maybe total station, and also we also use GPS to locate another point. Because especially in Lotus Tower, our main body was when we go up, we are above all building. We cannot, there is no line of sight. And other thing is that it moves due to the temperature. It moves due to the wind. And we are in the air. We don't know our location. We cannot locate ourselves from that point. So the most of the people. Our engineers come around 3 or 4 for surveying because where the temperature and the wind effect are less, right? So we have finished the all survey before 5 or 6, right? So from that onwards we can measure and go, right? Otherwise that is a very important factor that I want to show you. So this is the laser method, the total stations, the top normal things, and also you can see this is outside. You can see there are pieces located in the tower. We know the volume. We can measure the pressure from here. You can locate the pressure and see where you are, whether the tower is moving or whether this location is correct. We can locate. So we have 3 such things to control the tower. So both controlling the vertical and the tower is the key to any building. If it is a building, it's a bit easy because we can easily transfer. But this is the tower itself. It is very, very the diameter of the tower is only 15 meters. So that is very slender. We have our laboratory, it's very important to have a laboratory. It's a very big project. Every big project has to have its own laboratory. They cannot take the cues to SLS or other areas because we have to get the results within 3 hours, 10 hours to remove the shuttering to take the form work out. You have to have your machines at the site. Other considerations, the B data effect, very important when the building moves. Due to the gravity, there are additional moments coming. So it's called second order analysis. So if you design a building, if your second order analysis is 10% more, let's say your is more than 10%, then you have a problem with your design. You better check. So it should be within the 10%. And the fire is the main issue because most of the people. Most of the time, it will not fall due to wind. It will not fall due to earthquake. It will be falling because of the fire. So the fire plan is, I advise you all to go for concrete. If it is steam, we have to use fireproofing. Don't take shortcuts. Very important. People are the most important thing in the building than the building. right? So they should be able to get away. Minimum fire rating should be 1 hour. Columns or walls we can have 2 or 3 hours based on the importance. The other one is the progressive collapse. You know, all know about the Ronald Point disaster where one tunnel went out and all the people dead. And the person, I read, the person who caused the damage is living. And this is another, okay, the tall buildings are targets. Targets of terrorists. This is Sri Lanka. Blowing the World Trade Center, trying to blow the World Trade Center, 1993. So they have carried a bomb, carrying a van, this is 800 TNT, but it could not burst. So it is, the structures doesn't go like that. So it has a very, very inherent strength and lot of redistribution is there. So we have to make sure that your structure is strong enough to protect it from bad people. And when there's the blast, you have a positive wave as well as a negative wave. So very important that you have the positive wave depends on the standard distance of the chart. So generally, when you design a tall building, it should be very much far away from the road, or there should be barriers to block large vehicles. Blasting because the terrorists want to do make a statement, so they don't try to blast a small 10-story building. So they will try to attack your precious building. So even there is a blast, you should make sure that you have enough blast structure to cater for that. If there is a column loss, then other structures should act, keep the structure safe, because most of the time you have to where we have another group called protective technology group where they are only looking at security side, where the security experts can say where the vulnerable columns are and more and also the key elements. We have to remove the key elements and see how our transfer structures are, and then these structures should be able to hold in case of a failure. And the other thing is the pressure will go at a lower level, it will be very high, and there will be upward pressure. Most of the slabs that we design is for downward pressure or downward load. So the upward load is very critical, so you have to provide double reinforcement up to about 7 to 8 floors to cater for this kind of incident. This is Oklahoma bomb bombing by an American soldier because he was upset that America didn't attack Saddam Hussein at the first instant. So he bought an 800 kilogram bomb and parked in front of the American security building, and then most of the building got damaged. Because the point the finger to the not to the terrorist but to subterranean. The idea what they say is because of the leak facilities, P12 at 400 center, these columns got blast. Okay. So anyway, if you do earthquake detailing everything, you are leak spacing with pillars, then you will be safe. And if it is an impact blast, very important tall buildings, the planes are there, we have to make sure that there are impact loads. So if this is the time history of impact load. So different impact possibilities, we have to assess the risk, and we based on that, you have to make sure this is taken care of. This is the, I will skip this, we all know this about the progressive collapse after the plane crash. We saw the total building collapse during 1 hour, and so many people died. So it is very important as structural engineers to avoid that. Assess the risk basis, because this is a tall building. If it is a tall building, you have larger risk because there is a possibility of this kind of attack. And the local standard
the tower house is very precious to us, where the TV stations are there and the hotels are there and the restrooms and all the services are up there. So if something happens to this column, these are all, this is a steel structure, and we try to study what will happen to the structure, whether the whole thing will, there can be 3,000 people at one time, 3,000 people. So we remove some of the key elements and so, try to study different this thing and look at different options in case what can be, how can we minimize the this thing. So we can see part of the structure will get affected at the lower floors, but upper floors can manage. So likewise, we have to do so many analysis, it is not a straightforward this thing. So I would also like to acknowledge these people who are behind me. Prof. Priyamidis, Prof. Das. Prof. Priyamidis is our mentor and also guided us to do all the design. And Prof. Das is the chief structure engineer, the team leader of the structural team at Lotus Tower. Prof. Nanaka is the concrete specialist for Lotus Tower. And Bhatia Vajrati Divina Kitman is the main man who is running the Lotus Tower project. Taranga is our modeling person. And our wing expert, Dr. Tishar, and Vasana is one of my former colleagues who helped me to design the higher hotel. Thank you. This is the view of, from Lotus Tower to City Park. Taken from column lapping, now all columns are weldable steel, very it's not so good to do welding in the site because welding in site is not so good. Better to do couplers in case if there's is a major, most of the steel is weldable steel, but if it is there's a major unavoidable scale situation, yeah, you can weld.
Very
good. And I just asked about 0.25
water cement ratio
you were
mentioning,
no?
It's less,
no? Yes. For point of the lower the water cement ratio, higher the grade. So you can go up to 0.21 to 0.2 also possible.
So you are doing the mixed design?
Yes, yes.
Every day you have to?
No, I mean, if you do one time, then after that you have to maintain that that water cement ratio. Point 0.25, you can go up to grade 80.
For a presentation, how we get it? Presentation.
That's of course, I wish this will be on the website, so you can go to the site. It's not really too good, anyway. It's there in the website, you can go through.
There are a lot of, you can, if you can give it like that, I cannot hand over my presentation because there are some information with respect to the projects. If you want any information, you just give me a call, I will give you the.
No more questions. So this is over to you. Thank you very much, the presenter. Giving us this very valuable presentation. So, earlier we might send the session committee president to hand over these suggestions. Thank you very much, President. So I should thank the presenter, Engineer Shiromal Fernando, giving us a very important presentation on this subject. And B.B. is a very vast area, so we will have another presentation in future on this game. Thank you very much for you for being here with us for this spending your time. I wish you the. We have seen this much of very big crowd here spending the time until 7 o'clock. So thank you very much for being us today in this success. Thank you.